Hey guys, Drifter here. Today I've got a video for you about the Blunderbuss, which is one of my all-time favorite Call of Duty weapons. You may remember it from Advanced Warfare. It's back in Call of Duty World War II. It's a big, goofy pirate Blunderbuss, which was a real weapon. Think about them as being rifles before there were rifles. It's kind of like a shotgun. You load your pellets in, you put the gunpowder in, you cut your own wick, you light it on fire. It's a goofy weapon, right? It's not the greatest weapon, but it is very, very deadly up close. Outside of up close, it's a potato, and I've got good gameplay for you today. Unfortunately, the very first game I unlocked this got put on Gustav Cannon. This is my first game with it, by the way, and on Gustav Cannon, I'm going to make very good use of this shotgun. I'm going to scavenge sniper rifles, I'm going to scavenge the Stinger, I'm going to scavenge and use a lot of the new weapons that have been added in the Undead event. It's going to come down to the wire and going to be a fantastic game. I think you're going to enjoy it, and there is a giveaway link down there below in the description for some A40 headsets if you just want to follow me on Mixer. Super, super simple. But I want to talk about the gun. I like the Blunderbuss. I like this event, and I did get the Blunderbuss for free. Sort of, kind of. I grinded out challenges for a week to save up enough credits to unlock the Blunderbuss. I had to do weekly challenges, daily challenges, complete 3, complete 6, get lucky in a few drops, and I did have a head start with some credits from saved up from previous events, and a subscriber donated $10 for me to buy supply drops with on stream. Overall, it took me about 10 to 12 combined hours of work to go ahead and unlock the Blunderbuss. So, and it was free in a sense, but I had to work for it, and I stopped to think, well, how much money would I have made just working 10 hours at a normal job? Even minimum wage, I would have made significantly more money than required to buy the Blunderbuss. So why not just do that and then buy it with supply drops? Well, I have issues buying things with supply drops. And this is coming, all of this is coming from a guy who was initially very, very happy with the collection system where I can progress toward a certain reward, where I can save up my credits, where I get duplicate points, where I get a lot of different ways to earn things. I was very happy with World War II and with Modern Warfare Remastered. This supply drop system made sense. However, I've kind of fallen out of love with it. I came back and I was like, all right, I'm ready to try the new guns. Ooh, I don't want to spend money on new guns. What is this? Call of Duty forcing me to either grind out for hours and hours and hours to get new guns or pay for them suddenly became way less attractive, even though I was very happy with it 2 or 3 months ago. And I think that these new guns should be free. And you're going to say, well, Drifter, what changed your opinion other than the fact that you've been playing Fortnite and you don't have them? Well, there's no avoiding the elephant in the room right now that is Fortnite. Fortnite is a juggernaut Goliath of a game that cannot be avoided, and I can already hear the salty comments just being typed in right now from people that hate that game. It's saltier than the Dead Sea all dried out, saltier than a Morton Salt Factory, saltier than Diamond in League of Legends. There's people that don't like that game, and that's okay, but you have to admit that that's the big game right now. And the game has upended every single major gaming studio on the planet with content that is 100% for free. In Fortnite, and I know people hate this hearing this, when they launch a new thing, they launch a jetpack, a rocket launcher, a go-kart, something silly primarily in that game because it's childish. It's free. You just load up and you go find it and you play it. The map change, new map, free. New something something, it's all free. It's super easy to access. They do charge you an arm and a leg for cosmetics and skins, but for trying new gameplay elements, free. And being exposed to that level of free content has changed my perception, and I believe many other gamers' perception of value, similar with Overwatch and to a lesser degree Siege, since you have operators you have to pay for there. But this is a sort of change in value and distribution systems in gaming as a whole. For a historical perspective, in the 80s and 90s, when a game would come out, the game was just out. They would release a game, that was the game, however it was, you would never change. If it was bugged, that's just too bad, it'll be bugged until the end of time, some of them you couldn't even beat. And then, you know, kind of late 90s, early 2000s, a game could have an expansion pack. If a game sold really, really well, you could have an expansion pack added onto it. And people would buy those and play those, multiplayer as well. The expansion pack started becoming more of a locked-in thing as studios and developers started seeing the long-term value there. So they started doing DLC packs with games. That started with Halo and continued into Call of Duty. It was big on console, but it catched on PC too. And not very long after DLC packs, in probably about 04, 5 started. About 2008 or 9, you start seeing season passes, where we guarantee you monthly or semi-monthly, however tiered, releases of maps and content. That was very popular. Gamers were very happy with it. Then you start seeing games showing up that have in-game microtransactions, where you don't pay for maps or sometimes even for the game. You just spend a little microtransactions, about 2011, 2012. Then you start seeing games that are primarily completely free to play, about 2014, 15, 13, maybe somewhere in that range, where you don't pay anything for the game. You just load in and you don't even have microtransactions. You just buy random boxes. You just spend pennies here and there on loot boxes. Then finally, more recently, about 2017, 2018, you start seeing games swinging back the other way, avoiding loot boxes altogether and going for a fixed price access model or for a completely free model. I never thought I would see this. I thought when loot boxes came into gaming, loot boxes would just be the thing until the end of time because consumers could hardly understand the value of it. I think that EA's Battlefront completely soured so many people on loot boxes that it sort of forced a mega market shift back the other direction. It forced legislation, and it's, as much as it was bad for that game, it might have been good for the overall gaming community. And the hand of the free market, or the dollar votes, are starting to speak very, very loudly. You see a lot of developers pulling away. Of note, EA's Battlefield 5 is going to have maps for free and no loot boxes. Battlefront had maps for free, but with loot boxes. Call of Duty Black Ops 4 is yet to make an announcement yet, though I would suspect they're going to do maps and content for free in order to keep up with Battlefield and compete with Fortnite and other games. And after most of the other games I play just started dropping new content for free, new maps, new characters, new guns that you can just load up and use, Call of Duty caught me off guard a little bit. That I hadn't played World War II in a little bit. I've been going hard on Fortnite and a little bit of Overwatch and Siege and stuff. I'm putting my PC to use, so moving a little bit more away from my console. And I'm like, oh yeah, dude, new content dropped on COD. Undead, this looks super fun. All these guns look super fun. I'm just going to get on and play this. And I played the maps and I played the modes and I had a great time. And I'm like, all right, it's time to unlock some guns. Oh my God, they're so expensive. And I thought to myself, well, how much do they cost? It's, I can spend like 10, 15, 20 bucks off stream and not support loot boxes, really. And it'll be fine to spend a little money to get something to make content on. And then I realized, well, I'm buying loot boxes and I could theoretically spend $100+ and I wouldn't get all of the guns, or not necessarily guaranteed one of them, though that's kind of unlikely, you know. And I realized that my value as a gamer had changed. I no longer desired to pay money to access new content because all the other games I was playing was giving me new content for free. And that's not to say that the Attack of the Undead event isn't fun, quite the opposite, it's rather fun, or that the content they released is bad, or the guns are bad. The Blunderbuss probably is a bad gun in a lot of ways, but it's a really fun gun. Or to say the people at Sledgehammer that are working their ever-living asses off right now to turn Call of Duty World War II around don't deserve to get paid, because the opposite is true there. But just, I've been exposed to so many different things that have been giving me stuff for free. My values and value system and my attention span as a consumer has been changed by other products, and it wouldn't surprise me if other gamers have had this exact same experience as well. I believe that the entire gaming market is about to go through a proving ground this fall, a battle of the fittest, natural selection, survival of the fittest, I should say, last man standing, winner take all, because you've got so many different competing business models. You've got the $60 games, they come with season pass maps and microtransactions. You've got $30 games like Overwatch and PUBG, that where you get everything but there's cosmetics layered on top. You've got $60 games with free maps and drops. You've got games that are completely free and have drops, or games that are completely free and have cosmetics. You've got a few crazy games, a lot of early access stuff that's just free, and they'll figure out how to monetize it later. But there's so many different business models for gaming this fall. When you pick your game, it's almost going to be as important to pick your long-term spending model as it will be what kind of game you want to play. And I honest to God believe that this fall, and probably throughout the rest of 2019 and the next year and a half to year, we are going to see a lot of these business models go the way of the dinosaur. I think that only one or two are going to emerge victorious, and we will see which that is. And you're going to say, well, obviously that's the one that gives the worst stuff away for free. Well, not necessarily, because you got to remember, the stuff costs money, right? It may be a hard pill for you as a gamer to swallow, or Activision from the other perspective, but new content can't be free. There has to be something that gets paid. There has to be some gamer somewhere, somebody that pays for all this stuff. And let's say that people don't want to buy guns in Call of Duty and they want to go play with shopping carts in Fortnite. That's fine. But if the shopping carts in Fortnite are being given away for free, what if Epic Games is losing money on that? What if Call of Duty is making money on a smaller player base? How much is a single player worth? How much can a player reasonably expect for free? And which company is willing to give a player that much free stuff in order to get their attention and hope to monetize in the long run? I don't have all the perfect answers for this. I am not an industry analyst or a marketing analyst or a statistician or have access to any back-end data or anything. But I know that a big change is coming, and it's going to come within a year or two, which is relatively fast. And if you're speaking like Fortune 500 company speak, that's only a couple quarters of planning. And I think the whole gaming industry is going to turn upside down, and only a few business models are still going to stick. Personally, I think Call of Duty World War II should have some new guns for free. They tend to do that kind of after the event's done, after a few weeks. They keep them restricted so people come in and spend the supply drop money, and then a little bit later they'll go ahead and scale them back. But I think that dropping day one new content so people could come in and play it would be the best way to go, kind of at least keeping up with the Joneses with Fortnite. But I want to hear what you have to say. I want to hear your opinion, and I want to know if you enjoyed this video. Don't forget to like, favorite, and subscribe. Drifter out.